God for how he let me meet. I keep calling her Pastor West. She keep saying, I'm not a pastor. I don't know, it just keep coming out. sometimes you can pastor people in ways that you may not think of just because you don't wear a title.
All right.
But I just thank God for the man in the house, pastor, this wonderful pastor and his wife. To all my father's children, I thank God for y'all being here. I'm not anybody special, praise God. I'm just a willing vessel to be used by God.
Yes.
I don't have time to tell my testimony because it's real long and it's real powerful. But I know what it's like to be a teen mom. I was a teenage mother. Not because I was fast and wild beyond my years, but it was because I was naive and I was the eighth child out of 10. And so you kind of like, there are nobody special, just another mouth. My mother never made me feel like that, of course, but that's just how you feel. Just because it's hard to give 10 kids attention, individual attention, that they need. And so the enemy know this, so he makes sure he sends somebody along that will give you attention, and it can be the wrong kind of attention.
Right.
And so in all of that, I got pregnant about, I must have been about 13. I had my child at 14, he was born 2 months early. So I didn't find out till I was about 7 months pregnant, 6 months pregnant. Then I had him when I was 7 months, and he weighed 2 pounds and 14 ounces.
Mm-hmm.
And they said that neither one of us was going to make it through the night. But I thank God for my mother, because like I tell people, she didn't have a legacy of money, but she had a legacy of Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God.
Sit on, you know, we were at gospel. Yes. That I'm still God's kids. It's not about being rebellious. I don't know how to rebel against God. Even when I was a child, I was always compliant. Sometimes that can get you in trouble if you don't know the difference. But I was always compliant. God always gave me the ability to be able to say yes. And
yes, yes.
It's hard to kick against the prick.
Yes.
I'm telling you, if you do it God's way, it's going to be so much easier. And when I met First Lady Plants, I don't know why I did that. I just charged it to God. But anyway, because she was co-laboring this venture, and that brings me to a thought that I had. See, women, society tells us that we're second-class citizens, and that, you know, because we're women and we're the weaker vessel and we're this and that. But somewhere along, I heard that can't nothing come into the doors of this life, into the realm of this world, unless it comes through a female.
Come on now.
So women need to know their rightful place.
Yes.
God looked and said it was not good that man should be alone, so He gave him a woman to help. In order to help something, you got to be as strong as or stronger. Because you support.
Yeah.
So it's got to be strong.
Yes.
You can't be weak and help somebody.
Come on, you can't
be in quicksand trying to pull somebody else out, but then you're going to go down. So that's why women, as women, we have to build up our most holy faith. You can't do it in yourself.
All right.
You can't subscribe to what society say, all that, I woke up like this and all that foolishness. That's up to them.
Right.
And too many saved women try to live by the world's standards. Because that's not going to get us. All this sex and all that, that's not going to get us. Because if it would, then, I mean, we wouldn't hear the horror stories we hear. So, and beauty fades, see, but a woman that feareth God, see, that's what you want to do. You want to fear the Lord. That's most important.
That's it.
Don't never let nobody make you feel bad because you fear God or because you live a modest life and you're not all out there and trying to do the most. I am a social worker by profession, and I said all of that just because I see a whole lot of stuff where children are concerned.
Yes.
And just like the lady that was talking about how her heart bleeds for kids, I see it firsthand. But I see a lot of broken women trying to parent children that they're not ready for. You know, they've come from brokenness and they don't have what they need to give to the kid. It's not so much that they don't love their children and blah, 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 and all those other things. But you can't give something you don't have.
That's right.
And so I just thank God for who He is. Because He's more than enough.
Yes.
And I wanted to talk about unwrap the gift, because First Lady told me that was going to be the theme. And so I prayed and I asked the Lord, and it kind of go along with the thought when it gets down here and it talks about she listens for His voice and seeks His blessing, talking about God. In a world that screams for attention, a woman with a gentle and quiet spirit impresses God.
All right.
You may not impress other people, but you impress on God.
Come on now.
I went through a lot of trials and tribulations when I was 23 years old, but I was determined to hang on to God. And so somebody came out of we were having prayer service, and a brother just come from nowhere, and he said, "Sister Vicki, God just wanted me to tell you He's bragging on me." Well, I didn't know what it meant. And then later on, they preached about Job. And so then I got it, because I didn't understand why I was going through so much suffering and so much pain and so much drama. And I was like, but I knew that one thing, that became my favorite scripture. It says, "Though He slay me, yet when I trust Him." I don't know nothing else to do but trust God.
Yes, that's it.
I don't care what men say. I don't care what people say. I don't care what people try to pronounce over your life. God has the final say.
Yes.
He had the first say, so he's the only one. Talk all you want, because I will rebuke you. I'll turn it, I'll tell them, I'll reverse the curse every time. And if it's contrary to what God said, I'm going to tell you what thus said the Lord. Or I might look at you and say, thou says. That's what Jesus did. Mm-hmm. I ain't got to argue with you. That's what thou says. That's not what I believe.
Yeah.
So, getting into the message, unwrap the gift. Romans 6 and 22 and 23. I'm trying to be short. I've already heard a lot. And it said, for the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I thank God for that. That is a gift.
Yes.
God was a gift. I mean, when he said his son Jesus, in the person Jesus, he's still God. He made a woman as a gift. And it's just so many gifts wrapped up in one package. And so when you have a gift, not like the ones in the gift bag, but like the one in the box that the pastor, I mean, Sister Wes got, that she has, it's wrapped up and it's bound.
Come on now.
It's all tied up.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't know what's in it.
Yeah.
And this is for the whole house, because God has given. He's moved y'all from one place to another. And that's how God does. One water, one planet, but God gives the increase.
All right.
So maybe the area you were in is like Jesus when he said, now I must needs go to Samaria. He couldn't stay with them people that long. Now God got you over here.
All right.
But the Lord is going, he needs the gifts to come forward.
All right.
So this ministry can continue to flourish and be what God would have it to be. People think sometimes that the man of God and the woman of God can do it all. And God gave them, all of you all, to get up under them like Joshua and Caleb did when they lifted up Moses' hands.
Come on.
They won the war.
Every time
their hands got tired being human beings, Moses' hands, and they would go down, then they started losing the battle.
Mm-hmm.
So God quickened Joshua and Caleb to go up there and raise a man of God's hands and stand up and keep him up. I was talking about that support system, that being.
Right.
You have to be supportive. And whatever you do to honor the first lady, and you honor the pastor and the man of God, who is the angel of this house, you don't have to agree with it. You just have to just tell God if it's something you don't understand. You know, but you do what they say do, because there is a scripture in the Bible that says he'll take you one of a city, two of a field, and of a house, and he'll give you pastors according to his heart. And so we were talking about that being strategically placed.
Mm-hmm.
So God has strategically placed you upon this ministry.
Yes.
Under these people.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You don't get to tell them what to do.
Come on.
And
now,
you don't get to run them, and you don't get to disrespect them. You have to do what thus said the Lord. You use your gift.
Yes.
God is going to show the man of God, he's going to show the woman of God what gift to use, when to use it.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody has it all.
Right, that's it.
And so, but you're doing it as unto the Lord. So getting back to that wrapped up gift, we don't know what's inside of the box.
Mm-hmm.
We just know it's wrapped up. Mm-hmm. And the dictionary said to be wrapped means to be bound.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sin is bondage.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Come on now.
Until we won't know what's in there until we unwrap it. Sin enslaves our minds. It captivates our thoughts. Things we don't want to do or things that we're trying to stop doing, we find ourselves keep doing it over and over and over again. We have to repent. That's bondage.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why God sends a deliverer. It's the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
The Bible says that once you've laid the foundation of repentance, you have to go on to perfection. And so you have to get the Spirit of God. You know, Peter asked him, he said, have you got the Holy Ghost since you've been saved?
All right.
And they said, we haven't heard of such a thing as the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. You can't live this life without the Holy Spirit.
That's
just all it is to us. God is the key. The Holy Spirit is the key. But God, yes. Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, all three are one. It's just like they all that one, say all of them have the name Henry. So all of them is Henry, but they give me Henrys. So all three or however many come out of one, they derive from one name.
Amen.
So they may all have the same last name and they be like, well, Henry, who? You know, so then they got to differentiate by one and two. So that's how God differentiates himself through the Spirit, through Jesus being the Word, and the Holy Ghost being the Spirit of God, which is the nature of God. And he gives us that nature when we're born again, because we can't crawl back in our mother's womb, so we have to be born again by the Spirit and the renewing of your mind. And so, saying all that, things we don't want to do, we be trying to stop doing, and we bound over things like that. We find ourselves doing over and over. It's like a slave. Mm. And Jesus said that he came to set us, to set the captive free.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And see, it's time out for the children of God living beneath their privileges.
Oh, yes.
I mean, I think if I was God, that would be like slapping me in my face. I'm giving you all these gifts, and you like, break. You know, and you go do something else.
Mm-hmm.
Well, instead of using the word, instead of using the gifts that God gave you and getting the victory over the enemy, we try to use carnal devices.
Mm.
We be like, okay, if the Bible said God gives seed to the sower, instead of us praying and asking the Lord to give us that, we say, I'm going down to the bed alone. I already know what I'm getting ready to do. Trials and tribulations is doing to you, he gonna make you into what he wants you to be.
Yeah.
Somebody might be an urn, somebody might be a vase, somebody might be just a bowl. It just doesn't matter. Mm. It's all God's doing.
Yeah.
For by it we should be glad. So I said, if you come up any other way, you're a thief and a robber. Then God's gifts, the Holy Spirit, it empowers us. It gives us special abilities that are provided for the purpose of building up the body of Christ. It's not to be seen. Your gifts and talents is not so you can, you know, make a name for yourself.
Well,
it's for the glory of God and the building of His kingdom.
That's
When we give gifts, we don't do it for, we do it for a reason, to show our love and our appreciation, or to celebrate an occasion. So that's when we come to God's house, especially on Sunday mornings or whenever we come, people shouldn't have to beg us and prime us and pump us. Our hearts should be full. It should be glad.
Amen.
It should be overflowing. It should be coming out.
Right.
Thank God I survived another week. Woo! Yes. Because if the world said I can't talk about Jesus and I can't say His name and take that picture down off your desk and your little saying got to go over here. And so I'm glad to come in the house.
Come on.
Among like people where I can take my hat and all that off and I can tell.
In the back of my car, she puts her
But she always tell us to tell God. So she is a pastor in every sense of the word. So I give honor to her as a pastor. Ain't nothing wrong with shepherding. She'll accept that too, but that's just not how I feel. So I'll give honor to her in her absence. But she always tells us that God don't need no stars or no superstars. He already on all stars.
Yes, he do.
So he don't need none. And then it was a little song I used to say when I was young in the Lord, and it used to say, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. Mm-hmm. It took him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth, Jupiter and Mars. Oh, how loving and patient he must be, because he's still working on me. Doing better than this, but now I'm not getting ready to get over here and God, I'm broke. These people because you got stuff and things, that's not godliness. Gain is not necessarily godliness.
No. Amen.
It's better to have God. And then you have the gift of healing. You have the work of miracles that operates, should be operating in the church. If pastor's praying over somebody, it should be people that are gifted enough to know how to get with them. And help pray, then you, and break up the fallow ground, and you'll see miracles, and the Spirit of God will come in, and he'll begin to move. Because this, the church is supposed to be a hospital. People are supposed to be able to come to the church and get what they need and get healed and get saved. And the working of miracles still should be occurring among us, because we say we believe. And judgment's going to begin. It's going to first begin at the house of God, and where shall the sinner and the ungodly appear? The righteous going to scarcely be saved. So I'm just saying, the gifts are not operating in the church because we're bound.
Teach them.
We're too bad. We don't have liberty. I felt nothing but pure liberty when I came to this church. You can't go everywhere and feel that.
Mm-hmm.
You can't go everywhere and feel welcome.
Yes.
You can't go everywhere. They'd be like, who is this?
See.
What's she about? But that's the devil.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Don't ever let him use you like that. Amen. Don't ever let him. Tell him to get behind you.
That's it. Amen.
There's a gift of prophecy. It doesn't go forth like it should. There's a gift of discerning of spirits. Most people should be able to discern the spirit if you got the Holy Ghost, because it says that my spirit oppressed witness with your spirit, that we are the sons of God. And so everybody can't lay hands on me suddenly. Everybody can't pray for me. Yeah. I don't go everywhere.
That's it.
I don't associate with everybody.
Yeah.
Because if God give me the discerning of spirits, and that spirit is unclean and it's not evil, because Rahab, well, it was a woman in the Bible. It might be the wrong woman, but I want to say it was Lydia, one of them. They was running around saying, these are men of God, these are men of God. But they wasn't. That was a spirit in them, in her. Because it was trying to let the hit men know, these are men of God. That's who you're looking for. But it looked like praise. And so when Paul turned around and rebuked her, rebuked that spirit, and told her to come out the woman, people would be like, you ever been in a service for people that you've been fellowshipping with for a long time, and somebody calls up and praying, and they start casting out the devil? Or people be offended and be like, I don't have the devil in me. You know. Mm. But God gave him the discernment of a spirit.
That's it.
See, lying is a spirit. It's not just something people do. It's a demon. Make you lie. Make you steal. Then there's divers tongues. You can't be mad because somebody can speak in tongues. It's not a competition. Folks go around saying that they're going to give a class, and they're going to teach you how to prophesy. They're going to teach you how to have a conference over here. That's a gift from God. Anybody teach you that?
Amen.
Be the guy. But I mean, there's people that believe it. Folks get rich off of the gifts. That's what I'm telling you. And then there's the interpretation of tongues. And we need all the gifts operating in the spirit. We need it in the house of God.
Because
God sends sinners in them, they need to be saved. We're not to be looky-loos and just saying, we're going to see what's going to happen.
Right.
We're going to see how much power and grace God. We couldn't do nothing with that, you know. See, but it's because the whole body, we got to be on one accord. The Spirit of God to come in and flow freely and operate, do what it needs to be doing. Because guess what? If that spirit do come out, it's gonna look for somebody.
That's it.
You can't kill a spirit. You can bind it. You can cast it out, but you can't kill a spirit.
That's it.
There might be people who don't believe that, but you cannot kill a spirit, because a spirit is not flesh and blood.
That's right.
And so you have to know how to be in the spirit that has power and control over all the spirits. They have to come subject to the power of God.
See?
And he's the main spirit. And so we are stewards of the gift.
Mm-hmm.
We're to use these gifts to serve one another as well as to serve God. And then I'm moving on. And these gifts were not developed by human capacities. Therefore, Therefore, a believer has absolutely no right to brag on this gift.
Come on now.
You can't go around and be like, child, I'm gifted like that. No. We're supposed to be humble and be gracious and thank God for that. And know that the enemy's going to fight you the more gifts you have.
Come on now.
You run around telling me I can preach better than they can, or I can do it this way or that way, thinking these type of things, and the devil bringing that kind of stuff to your mind. And that comes with a price. But the more you know, the more of a threat you are to the kingdom of hell, I promise you, the more you're going to go through. So I tell people all the time, if you really want a ministry, you don't have to fight nobody about a pulpit and having a briefcase. Like our pastor tell us, your gift will make room for it. So you don't have to chase nobody down and ask for no invitations. God will just, he'll open doors for you that need to be opened and shut doors that need to be shut. You don't have to try. There's a whole host of people out there in the hell holes and the trenches. That's why Jesus sat with sinners and publicans, and he supped with them, because it ain't nobody breaking down the doors to go deal with the dope addicts and go down to the projects. And see, folks ain't doing that in the foster care system and all those types of people that are broken and need a savior. Because I tell all the people that I minister to that you don't need a social worker, you don't need Susan's social worker, you need the Christ. I am is the only thing that's going to deliver.
Yes, come on, man. Ephesians 5:17, 1 Timothy 4:11-14 says,
says, do not neglect your gift, which was given to you in prophecy with the laying on of hands. Stir up this gift continually by praying in other tongues on a daily basis. Kindle afresh, keep it full of flame. Notice that the word says we are to stir it up. The Holy Ghost is now within us. The Holy Spirit is not going to force you to pray in tongues. It's not going to pray in tongues for you.
Come on now.
When you pray in tongues, you're using the gift of tongues and you're stirring up the gift. We use our free will to pray in our heavenly language. The Holy Spirit supplies us with the utterance at the times of the interpretations of what we speak in tongues. The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses.
Amen. Yes.
Right. Through moaning and groaning that and utterance that can't be heard. Sometimes you can't do nothing but just say, sometimes you can just moan and rock. You don't always have to talk. God knows. Yes. The deep calls into the deep. Help means that literally to take a whole together with against, which means that, for example, if a friend is helping somebody move a large table, both of them take hold of it and then push against wherever it is they want to go. And so somebody helped them. It's just so it can accomplish the purpose of moving the table. And so Corinthians 3:6-9 tells us we are laborers together with God. So that means you got to be doing something too. And it don't just come like God. We want God to be like Santa Claus and just give us stuff.
All right.
But you got to labor with God. We plant and water the seeds of God's word, and the Holy Spirit confirms with signs following, and God gives the increase through His Spirit.
Yes.
Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to us. Mm-hmm. It seems that once Christians are baptized in the Holy Spirit, we develop mind and sit back and relax and intelligence. But it's not so. You got to build up your most holy faith. And the Bible tells us that speaking in tongues, it edifies oneself, and it helps you grow spiritually. Last but not least, this may be off track, but I wrote it down just because the Lord gave it to me.
All right, that's all right.
1 Peter 4:11, and it says, if anyone serves God, they should or must do so with the strength that God provides. That comes from the Holy Spirit. It's to lead God and keep us. So that in all things God may be praised and He may get the glory.
Yes.
If you suffer, it shouldn't be in vain.
Amen.
But for the gospel's sake, that's what you suffer for.
Yes.
I'm telling you, I work closely with my pastor, and a person that had been inviting me to the church, brought me there, and then she got jealous somewhere along the way because I came in asking God to put me to work.
All right now.
I asked the pastor, what could I do?
Yeah.
Because in the world, I wasn't no sit-down type, so I need to be doing something.
Hello.
And so she said, well, we got a van that don't nobody, the folks don't like to get up early. And I have CDL, so I said, hey. I went to work.
Right.
And so then she got offended and started crying and said she was leaving the church and I was making that all he is. I said, girl, God forbid, it's a whole lot of work you can be doing. She was actually the treasurer, but she was over the money because she had a job where she ran big money, you know, management. Everybody don't know how to handle a large amount of money. She was gifted money. Have to stay in your life. The children's family. Okay, so it was her that brought me there. And she got really offended because the pastor said it was a big happy prayer. But it wasn't just me driving the van. It was because I would get in the service and I would get up under the woman of God and I'd be praying and I'd be watching while the service was going on, and I'm praying and reaching out to God and my boy in the heavens and interceding and asking God to bless and I'm asking God to heat up the service and save those who need to be saved.
Yeah.
You know, just watch it.
Mm-hmm.
And so while we pray. And so that's the kind of gift that God gave me. And so she was like, the pastor said, I've been praying for somebody like you for the last 30 years. And she shouldn't have said that. She took so offense to it. And she said, well, I've been here 3 years, you know. I was your first Christian, you know.
Okay, girl, you're not serving the pastor, you're serving God.
But anyway,
well, you should be.
When you're doing that, then your labor's in vain.
Right.
And that's why your feelings get up. And so, whatever you do, the Bible says, do it unto the Lord.
Yeah.
Do it for the gospel's sake.
Yeah.
We often find ourselves tired, and we can hardly summon up the energy to lift ourselves up, because God intends that we speak as an oracle of God, no matter what our circumstances are, no matter what our emotions are. What we share is a priceless gift that Christ gave to each of us when he gave his life for us.
Right. Amen.
You do have value. You have worth. Never let the enemy beat you down and tell you who you are and who you are not. You got to know this. You got to confess that on your life. The enemy going to come day and night whispering. Everybody be fine. I know how faith is, how to work with it. But I prayed about it. My son was, he's a human resource, and he just kept,
Bobby, is it going to get you a bigger job? Because he was like, you know that when you retire, that makes your wages higher, and blah, blah, blah. He was looking at it from a monetary standpoint, which is a blessing.
And so I went because God wanted me to launch out into the deep and come out of my comfort zone and put myself in his hands, because I was like, you know me, Lord. And one of the people, she put it on Facebook to become one of my greatest friends. And God had really used her to bless me a whole lot. Mm-hmm. And when I went through unemployment, she was a major blessing to me. But when she first came, she said, oh, I can't see this blue-eyed blessing. And I said, that would be me. And I asked her who she was. But I tried to tell them, I might just come in a package and look like what they expected, or I didn't have 6-inch stilettos and I didn't wear Prada and all of that. And so I came in the name of the Lord, like David said. You came to me with knives and swords, but I'm coming to you in the name of the Lord. Lord's doing, what about all of our blood? Because they asked me, did I have to take a stay? I said, I ain't mad. Mm-hmm. And for 5 long months, I'm telling you, God took care of me. Thank you.